Hi, I'm Mary Stevens. I'm president of the Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School PTA. This is Martha Mothershead, who is president of the George Mason PTA, and Shauna Russell, who is president of the Combined Elementaries PTA. And the three of us got together and conceived of this town meeting with speakers and to cover all different areas of the schools that we thought were of importance to all the school community, and we are so excited to see how many people came out tonight to do this. No one is probably more happy about it than the people who've been speaking for years to just a handful of us. But that's fantastic. I just wanted to say that one of the wonderful things about living in a small community such as Falls Church City is the access that we have to community leaders and to our elected representatives. And this is, you know, one of those kind of amazing events that you have in a town like this that you really don't in a place that's bigger. Before we get started, I wanted to thank our principals for coming. You have long, hard days and nights, and Kathleen Haleko is here from Mount Daniel. I think I saw Mr. Palermo is here from Thomas Jefferson, and Mr. Bird is here from Mason. Mrs. Ashaheed is actually in the building, but she's being picked up. She's not feeling well at all, and nobody wanted to be near her and get contagious, you know, catch what she has. So she would have definitely been here as well. We are all pleased to welcome tonight Dr. Jones, our superintendent of all the school, the Falls Church City Public Schools, School Board Chairman Susan Kearney, and some people from your office, I believe, are here as well. Mr. Kimball, our assistant superintendent of finance and operations, and Lisa High, curriculum and personnel. And then we also, from the city of Falls Church, we have Mayor, Baroukh, and City Manager Wyatt Shields, and then there was the Assistant Mayor, Vice Mayor, who's also with us. Shauna had a brief business announcement about.
Just a quick item, as I'm sure everyone's aware, in this city and even just within the schools, there's always multiple things going on at any given night, so there's always some conflict. And right now, tonight, there's an affordable housing forum going on, and so they just dropped off their affordable housing, their draft policy, so if anyone's interested on your way out, you can pick one of those up, and they're just looking for a public comment.
So if we could please get started with Dr. Jones and talking about the.
And Mr. Kane has a very quick, we promise quick, food service announcement that's like 1 minute, he's promised.
1 minute in the time and starting now. Anyway, as you know, this year, USDA has implemented new rules for the food service program. Those rules, the major impact was for the high school, 2 ounces of meat was the maximum, the instituted minimum and maximum amounts of calories in subgroups of food that we could give the students. 2 ounces of meat, I don't know if any of you are aware what that looks like, but it's smaller than the palm of my hand. And as you know, we have some growing children here in the high school and in the middle school. And for the first time, we had a lot of complaints about the kids still being hungry. So, what we're thinking about doing, and we're looking for feedback from the parents, I've spoke to the students and to the staff, is about getting off the National School Lunch Program just for the middle school and the high school. Now, that doesn't mean that we're not going to follow any kind of healthy rules, because we'll still give healthy meals. But USDA is coming out with more rules for next year to regulate a la carte and anything else there is, and if there are any indication of what it's like for this year, which was very tough to implement, we expect it to be even harder next year. So I just wanted to put that out there. You can email me with your feedback. The students were very unhappy with it, and we don't want our kids to be hungry. We want to feed them healthy meals, and we want them to be able to make a conscious decision on what to eat instead of the government saying you only can have this amount and put everybody on a diet. So that's my 1 minute, I think, Amanda. Thank you.
And I just have to say, when he showed me it, because I wanted to see, what does it look like in pictures? Like, what is the difference? And when it was one chicken nugget on the plate, and I'm looking at our high school students, that just is not a lot of food. I couldn't just eat one nugget. I know that. And I'm going to apologize in advance that I may have to sit down in order to be able to click over here. So, is it? Mine's not working with this one. Is yours working? Okay. I'm going to start out just, truthfully, this is a topic that I could stand up here for 3 hours when we talk about our facilities. And I know I have 20 minutes. And so what I'm trying to do is give you a big overview, but then also when you leave, know so that you'll be educated to know where to go to find out more information. So if you have a specific interest because your kids are little and you want to know more about TJ, you'll know where to go to get that information. If you're more interested in the George Mason facility, then you'll know where to go for that. And when we talk about facilities, obviously in Falls Church right now, everything is being driven by our student growth trend. And I think it's really important that when we take a look since 2005, we have around 400 children that have been added to our school system. And the way that I always think about that...
There's teamwork for you.
Awesome. Thank you. And the way that I like to think about that is that's the size of Mount Daniel. Okay, so we've added a school to our system. And when you think of it that way, it's a lot. The other thing, I'm considered the new person on the block. I've been here, this is my second year, but 200 of that has been since I've been here. So that just gives you an idea of the growth trend and what the cycle is looking like for us. Now, when you get ready to go and find our facilities master plan that was just updated, the plan actually started, and there's lots of detail. I mean, it's 300 pages. There's a lot of detail online for you. You just go to our website. That's where you'll find us. So that's why I have the link up here. And if you never go to our website, a lot of parents don't, it's amazing. We have one of the best web designers truly in the country for schools. John Brett does a great job for us. And it trends every day. So you're always looking at brand new content. When you're on the website, you go over to the school board section, go straight down, and you'll find facilities master plan. Once you get on the main page, there's general information. You'll see your home page, and that kind of just scrolls through different pictures. The one thing I do want to point out, down on the bottom, on the footer, you'll see that there are lots of different companies listed. And sometimes I don't think the community always realizes how much work our school board has done over the last few years. It's not just, a couple of work sessions and discussions. All of these experts in the field have been involved in the development of this facilities master plan that started. It really started, the actual date is 08. On a lot of print, you'll see 2009. And then again, with our growth cycle, we're continuing. It's a working document. We have to update it all the time. Dewberry is a huge company, which I know. That was them. They were involved in the very first 2009 study. The Robert Paul Jones has done land assessments and values for us. Hess is working on the TJ project. Arcadis is our construction management. They were also guided us in this process at MEH when it was new. Luke Meyer is an engineering and construction firm, our engineering and architecture firm. And then Weldon Cooper is who we're using for all of our population. And when we talk about our population data, that's one aspect that we changed a little bit this year. And in the past, we have always done, we've always done our own enrollment. And when we've gone through and looked at our enrollment projections, they've been very, very accurate. And Mr. Kimball, we give him credit for it. We call it the Kimball model. He's born and raised here, graduate here. He knows things about our city and kind of has the knack, I guess, for enrollment. He says there's not some major scientific study, it's just his head. But it's amazing how our scientific study with Dewberry matches his head. So when you look at the Dewberry study, I just wanted to point out that all of the background and how the study was developed, you can look and see who was on the committee. It involved people from the community, school board, staff, huge. Lots and lots of time went into the development of the study. I'm going to start out by looking at enrollment and capacity because, again, it does drive everything really that we do. When we look at the methodology, again, we're using Dewberry, which is an independent party, so that we felt like that was very good to use a credible source for all of our projections going out 20 years. And it does use two different models when you look at the projections. When you look at this model, what you'll see is in 2012, get it back down so you can see it. When you look at 2012, what you're seeing here is a birth rate model projection. It's one way of modeling out what our projections are expected to be, because it's pretty accurate because they're looking at birth rate and the development of this area. So Weldon Cooper looks at Falls Church City area as well as birth rate. And those have all of the numbers for us that have the percentages. And again, all of this is online because I know some of this, there's a lot. When you get down to the bottom, you'll see that there are bigger numbers and their cohort numbers by school. And that's because you don't have the birth rate for those years out. So they have to use a different model that's a cohort model. And that is, and even Weldon Cooper will tell you, that's very, very challenging. Can we tell you how many students are going to enroll in 15 years? They do the very best job they can with all the scientific knowledge that they have. Down on the bottom, the one thing you'll notice is that when you look online at the charts, the chart that was done by Weldon Cooper does not include the economic development. So we do have charts that include economic development. So as the new development is coming online, we truly know we have the Weldon Cooper projections of true growth in the city, and then if we have something like Rushmark or Northgate coming online for economic development, we are adding that in as well so that we know our true percentage that we expect to grow. And I credit the city. We've worked very closely together on trying to make sure that when they're putting in a unit where we have a formula to know if there's a new condo coming in, a condo building, how many children do we expect to get based on all the trends that we've seen. So we're working very hard together. I think I chose a slow computer. When we go in and look at the different, we have Cherry Street, a section on Cherry Street, which will be the new pre-K, and that will start, technically it starts construction not next December, because that's when the building is vacated. There are somebody in that building right now. There's lots of pictures and things on here for Cherry Street, but I'm gonna go ahead and jump to, again, because of time, to Mount Daniel for you. And when you look at what I want you to understand with facilities is where we are and why the school board is so proactive when we talk about our CIP. Because of capacity issues. We're at capacity everywhere, and a lot of people don't realize that. There are two different color lines on here, and the Cherry Street, this one is different because when Cherry Street comes online, pre-K comes out of Mount Daniel, so it does help us a little bit, 30-odd students, not a whole bunch, but it does help. But what you're seeing here is the trend line of where that building is supposed to be and where it is even, you know, right now. I mean, it's full. Mount Daniel's at capacity. The next one I want to show you is Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson looks a little bit better, but I'm going to be very honest. It's one that kind of makes you a little bit nervous because we have new construction going on there right now. When the new construction opens, we're built to have 8 classrooms on each section. Our rapid growth, we're having a lot at elementary. And to give you an example, after Christmas or after the winter holidays, overall numbers didn't go up huge amounts, but for instance, like at TJ, we enrolled 20 students, but we only had 3 that left. So that means you have another class of students that came in after the break. And we notice it when the buses, that's usually where you really see it. You go to a bus stop, and I was explaining to somebody that one of our bus stops that had 70 some odd when we came back after winter break, they were counting heads because there were 91 at the same stop. So it's really, when we look at TJ, where you see that trend line, when we open, TJ, based on what we know now about next year's numbers and where we are, we will have 8 sections on each grade level. That's what, with new construction, we are built for. So that just gives you an idea why the school board is being so proactive in trying to really work on facilities. And again, I'm going to remind you that when you look at these projections, that does not have the economic development on that chart. And not that it's huge, but it still adds percentage. So it's still going to go up a little bit from that. This is MEH. And when you look at MEH's chart, their trend line is, and let me just make sure, their actual capacity is right here at the top of that red. So MEH does have a few years to breathe, but then MEH will be full because they're built for 600. Right now they're at right about 500, just over 500. And this is George Mason. And again, when you look at Mason, this is their trend line where they're supposed to be. They're already above that. Now, the one thing on these charts, when you, if you are home and you're having a look at them, we look at capacity two different ways right now, just so it helps us. And it will say, like at George Mason, if we're talking about the actual building, which is 780 students, we're over 900. But we do have trailers that have been there for a long time. So if we count the trailers, it's 900. So we're at capacity even with our trailers at George Mason right now. But we try to look at the actual building because we all know trailers really aren't a long-term solution for us. Now across the top again, when you look at, when you go back and you look at the different school sites, and I'll go for instance to George Mason, and when you go, when you click on it, you'll see over on the side it gives you the different headers, all the different sections that you can go in and look at for facilities. Inside this facilities master plan, sometimes somebody wants to know how old is the heat and air, how old is the generator, depends on what your interest is. If it's capacity or student enrollment projections, those are on here as well. We also have just the architectural assessment. What are the construction program needs for something like George Mason? And I'll just see if we can. And again, this is several years worth of work. So it's lots of different pieces that have come together to make a master plan. When you go into the attachments, one thing that you'll find, and I caution you in a facilities master plan, is part of the planning phase is modeling. You know, you can't go into a construction project without having some pre-thought about what is it that we want to do. So you go in and look at how many students, you're looking at what is the square footage that we need, what sort of program design might fit on this piece of land, how could it be configured, does it need to be multi-story? So for instance, George Mason's probably one, it's kind of a fun one to look at because from the Dewberry study, when you click on the actual pictures, there's several different models. How could you fit a high school on this land and build without vacating the current high school? Because when you think about it, where do you move all of the students while you're building the high school? Not that you can't do it, but they really spend a lot of time modeling. So when you're on this site, you'll be able to click out and look at those if you have an interest in that. There's also scope of services. What does it look like in a planning phase? What is the zoning map? If you want to know about soil and all of those things for George Mason, question I get all the time, how old is it really? So, you know, if you're looking at things like the HVAC, is it really that old? Yeah, that's really that old. We do try to update elements, obviously keep the building safe, try to keep those renovations going to the best of our ability, but the facility is old and aging, and it does show up when you go inside and look at all the components. This just gives you an idea of what you see when you see modeling, and this is why I always caution when you're looking at a facilities plan, because when you're looking at what can happen, and you can see this whole front is kind of a new area of George Mason, and so when you're looking, this is actually, I think, this is option scheme A, but it doesn't mean that's definitely what we're going to do. There's so much planning that goes into the process. And then those of you that are watching the watching TJ Project, some of you are on the ASAC committee, know it takes a whole year just a planning process. So you go out, you look at all the different models, all the different options, and then community, staff, everybody weighs in on what is the best way to move forward. And especially when you start talking about something like a high school that needs to be a 21st century high school. You know, you have to have your technician there talking about technology. We have to have our heat and air person around the table talking about that. We have to have teachers there is the square footage where we need it? You know, where do we need common areas? We have to have safety and security there to make sure we've, you know, looked at all of those issues. So these are models that are out there for you. Something back too far. Sorry, I lost my link here. Now I'm going to go in and just show you, we'll look at Mount Daniel. And Mount Daniel has a lot of information. We have a plan right now on the CIP for Mount Daniel. And those of you that watch the CIP, we just approved our site-based, our school-based CIP last night that will go to City Council. The plan that's in on there for Mount Daniel, is that the plan will definitely 110% do? We can't really say that right now. We just know the planning needs to begin. But what we do know is if we have to build on the current site, what is what will fit there? How many rooms can we build? How much square footage can we gain? And so when you go on this site, you'll be able to see what that actually looks like. And I'm going to see if I can. So this is an option, and you'll see on the plan it actually says 4A. That's because they looked at lots of different plans last year when we worked with Luke Meyer Engineering on how can we actually go in and design and do a renovation and a build there that will expand on that particular site. So when you look at this, this is what's in the CIP now, but again, we're really having to go back and think a lot about elementary. Mount Daniel grew 9.5% this year. So as a division, 4.5% has been a challenge, but to have a K-1 building that grows 9.5%, and we know that we're almost maxed out on the land, we're trying to be proactive and really do lots of think right now to make sure that what we build has a long-term strategy. This is what's in our CIP, and it does add, it's a double story on the end. One of the things we really want fixed, if we have to stay in that current building, this building's not ADA accessible at all. And those of you that have children there or have been in that building, you can't take children down the hall to the playground if they're special needs children because there's huge stairs. And those children actually have to go outside and around just to get to the playground. So we're fixing ADA. This is a two-story building, multi-story. It redesigns all of the entrance for Mount Daniel, moves the media center to enhance and expand that. It needs to be bigger than what it is. Moves the office area. And I know Ms. Haleka, who's been here for a long time, said, well, that's where the office used to be, or the classroom. Where the offices are now used to be a classroom. This model actually goes back to that, so that you're keeping your classrooms close together. It also expands so that you have a separate cafeteria gym area, because with a big school, it's very difficult to take children to PE when they're having lunch, where you would normally have PE. So they really need to have those spaces as the school grows. So again, I encourage you to go online and look at those. And tell me when it's time to stop, because I'm telling you, I really could go on for three. There's so much stuff in here. And I'm trying to just show you the big highlights. Let me just show you TJ. And TJ is a lot of fun. If you haven't driven past in the last week, you know, people ask all the time, are they really doing anything there? Are they really doing anything? I promise they're really doing it. There's a lot of work behind the scenes. Then all of a sudden when the steel goes up, it just changes within weeks. And so if you haven't been by, it actually looks like a two-story building now. And with TJ, again, there's site utilities. All of their information's been updated for this year, so you know that the things that we're working on, like their heat and air system, will be dated, you know, from the current dates. When you look at their site plan, you look at their what a first floor plan looks like, and just gives you an idea of what we're doing there. And again, ASAC committee involves people from the community, teachers, everybody has weighed in on this. So, and at TJ, it's worked really well. I think Mr. Palermo would agree that pretty much almost everything that comes out of ASAC, we then take to the whole staff, and then they vote online and kind of weigh in and give us their opinion on to make sure we're building a building that works for teachers and children. And it's built in a pod. So what you're seeing if you drive by now in that two-story structure is this pod structure, and then it connects with a hall. And then there's also an expansion of the cafeteria and additional storage for daycare and science storage. It also does have, there are 15 classrooms, but one of the classrooms is a science room. So it's built specifically for science at TJ. And I'll just show you the site plan so that you know what that looks like. This is what, when you look at the footprint of the building on a plan, you know, again, and I think I haven't had very many questions lately, so I think John Bredigan's done a great job messaging and sending pictures out so people know kind of how this project is developing. The blacktop went away, but the blacktop gets expanded when they're finished, so that comes back for the children. All of the play equipment that's out here is untouched. There's parking that goes in over here. That's a requirement. We had to increase parking in order to increase the building. And then there's like a little commons area here. I will say this orange piece, the teachers actually took that out in the end. It was going to be like a little sitting area, and they thought, who's going to sit while they're all playing and out at recess? And they just didn't feel like it was a great space. So they traded it for something else inside the plan. The last thing I'm going to show you is just on George Mason to let you know that on all of our properties, we're being very proactive in making sure that we're doing a lot of pre-planning for everything. It takes, I mean, it really does take years of community involvement, of working on programming and planning. And one of the first things that we have to do, for instance, for George Mason, is knowing, you know, what are you building a building for? So we've gone in, updated all of our projections. We know that when you look at that projection chart, I know a lot of you will probably go home and look again thinking, how big are we going to be? But when you look at that, we expect to build a building for 12 to 1,300. Now, the great thing about building a high school for 12 to 1,300 is square footage-wise, it doesn't really go 12 to 13. You actually can go up to 15 by the square footage that we're building. So if we did have some extra students, you can't go, you wouldn't want to go lower because then you'd be over capacity again. But you do always have a little bit of wiggle room depending on how you're building. So that will be helpful. But if you go on here, in the Dewberry study, the program was done. And when you say the program, it's every single classroom that we know we need. The size, the square footage is there. And I can't tell you exactly, but I'm going to say it's 275,000 square feet. And there may be a few extra when you get to the bottom. So we've done all of the pre-planning, and this has all been updated again. Our athletic director's gone through, made sure all the square footage matched, you know, what's current for this amount of students. We've gone through, we have things like a STEM lab. Instead of maybe an 09, it was called something else, and it was a space that wasn't as user-friendly. So all of that's been updated in here for George Mason, so the program is current. And we were able to do this because we do have construction management on site to guide the process. And so what this does is it eliminates just one step that we don't have to pay for, again, because we did it with Dewberry and we were able to update that. So that's all four facilities, and again, there's so much on here. It's all on the web, and if you have specific questions, feel free, you know, to give me a call. I'm more than happy. Your emails are the best. Over here are the plans that you can see on the inside. Really colorful, fun building. Again, the teachers voted on all of these colors for the inside of TJ. So if you haven't looked at that, it shows you that actual tile that will go in, what the patterns look like. It shows you where the blue is. That's the actual carpet. There is storage. The teachers were very, you know, as far as designing, how the sink looks, how much storage is in there. So we're really excited about how that project is progressing. And the teachers have really, the whole ASAC committee wants it to be a great place for children, really colorful. So we expect it to be a wonderful project. So now I'll turn it over to Ms. Kearney, who is our chair of the school board. It's on there. It's just that there's a big chart that's done by Weldon Cooper. And because it's done by an outside source, we don't want to go in and mess with their numbers. So when you look down below, it will list each. And I will tell you, there's even more detail than that. Again, this is when you go online, working with the city, I mean, it literally tells you, we have a chart that tells how many students will come from the current, how many come from the current, like condos. That's usually what people are interested in, or departments, how many students we've been generating, because they have a great formula they're using for that with the city. And then underneath that, it actually has the percentage, and there's a little chart that says, with the addition of this Northgate, Rushmark, I would say that wrong, yeah, thank you, Rushmark, this is what our percentage will be. So it is on there, just know when you look at the very first chart. It's just Weldon Cooper.
Thank you, Dr. Jones. I have about 5 or 10 minutes they've asked me to talk, to give you an overview of the budget process, and I'm going to do that. First, I wanted to introduce you. Some of my other colleagues are in the room, and in case you have a question at the end of the evening, I want you to know who they are so you could snag them and ask a question if you had one. Back on the right here is Kieran Sharp. Back on the left here is John Lawrence. And in the middle is Justin Castillo. So feel free to grab them and ask them really hard questions at the end of the night about the budget process. We have begun the budget process on the school board. For us, the budget process begins in the November-December timeframe with the CIP. The CIP is the 5-year capital improvement budget. For us, it's primarily two things. One is buildings, the things that Toni was talking to you about, major renovation and construction of buildings. And the second is system upgrades and maintenance and those kinds of routine things. Resurfacing the track, putting up baseball lights, upgrading systems and air conditioning and those kinds of things. The school board did approve a CIP budget last evening, and we've sent it over the wall to our colleagues on the general government side. I just want to make a couple comments about that CIP, and then I'm going to move on to the operating budget. Over the past 2 years in the CIP, we have gotten fairly aggressive about the inclusion of a lot more projects to upgrade and enhance our school facilities. You saw in Toni's numbers why that is. We're running out of space, and our buildings are old. So as compared with last year's CIP, what you would see if you looked in our CIP is you would still see the completion of TJ, which is in there, and we'll put new kids in TJ starting next September. We're just beginning our community work on the Cherry Street Pre-Center. This will be for our littlest ones. We're very excited about the opportunity to have a place for those kids to learn. Mount Daniel is still in the CIP budget, as Toni mentioned. We've accelerated the timing a little bit because of the additional growth we're experiencing in the city. We're running out of space faster than we thought. And then we have included for George Mason's site money in the next fiscal year. Is that right? Yes, next fiscal year, to begin planning to figure out what to do with George Mason. And we have money in the following 3 years to actually begin to design and build whatever it is we need to have at George Mason. So this is an acceleration from last year in the CIP for budget as well for George Mason. I wanted to point that out because I think that was the one question that I got most last year at this forum was, what the heck are you guys doing about George Mason? And so we're trying to hustle that up because it needs to be done. And then another thing we have added to the CIP budget this year in an out year is a wing or an addition for this building, because as you saw on the charts, we're running out of space here too. So those are just some of the major changes in the CIP this year from last year. If we can find the will and the community support and the money and the organization, then in 7 or 8 years, we'll have the kinds of facilities that our kids need here in Falls Church. We'll have space for them, we'll have modern systems, and we'll have the kinds of schools I think we can be proud of. Not that we don't love our schools now, it's just that they're old. So that's about the CIP. That's the first step for us. What happens now is we send that to our colleagues on the government side. The Planning Commission will evaluate it after the staff has looked and made some recommendations. Eventually it goes to City Council for adoption. If you're interested in facilities, next week on the 17th, somewhere at City Hall, I'm not sure where, maybe Wyatt, you know. Is it here?
Dogwood Room
730. There will be a joint school board city council session on the 20-year facilities plan for the city, where we'll be talking about our school needs as well as city needs. And so that could be of interest to some of you, so I just wanted to point that out. Moving along, the next thing that we will be doing on the school board is our operating budget, our community services budget, and our food services budget. I'm not going to talk much about food services or community. Those are our smaller things. Operating budget is what we spend most of our time on. Toni has put up here the key dates for our budget calendar for the school board. It's available on our website as well, easily found. You'll notice that The next thing after next Tuesday is the 22nd of January, when the superintendent will be presenting to the school board her recommendations for our operating budget. So at this point, I can't tell you anything about it because I haven't seen it yet. I know that with growth in number of students, we expect to see additional staff. I know that with some of the events we've seen, unfortunately, in our nation recently, and the increased concern about school security, that we may see some additional funds and needs in that area for school security. But the one thing I did want to tell you is, over the past four budget cycles, I guess, since we had the Great Recession here in our country, the school board has done, to my mind, a very good job of what we would call responsible budgeting for our operating. We've worked very closely with our colleagues on City Council, and we have budgeted to the kind of guidance that they've given us based on the financial condition the city has been in, which has been strapped, as we all know. Unfortunately, in doing that, it appeared to us last year that some people in the city think that because we only asked for so much money, that all of our needs in the schools were met. And if you're a parent of children in the school, you know that we don't have all of our needs met in the schools. So in terms of the guidance that the school board gave to the superintendent to develop her budget this year, what we told her was that we need her to bring us a budget that reflects what we need. So this is a little bit of a difference for us. I don't know what it is she's going to bring, but this is what we've told her, and it's a little bit different guidance. So I just want you to be aware that that's a little bit change for us on the school board. The school board will then deliberate, according to this calendar. We will adopt a budget recommendation at the end of February. And we will do what the school board always does. We will ask for what we think is the right thing for our kids. We will ask not for a dollar more than we think, but nor for a dollar less. If you were here last summer, there was a lot of talk about technology and technology expenses. I think we can expect to see more of that in our budget request this year. If you listen to Toni talk about what's going on at our bus stops, we added a bus last year. We need to add some more buses this year. We may need to add some more buses next year for kids. So there just are a lot of things at play. We've been stretched for a while. We need to start catching up now that the economy and the city's finances allow that. So that's, I think those are things I wanted to tell you about the operating budget. Once we pass it, we send it over the wall. Wyatt Shields incorporates it in his city recommendation, and then we begin working with council to negotiate the transfer that they'll give us from the city. One of the things I wanted to tell all of you, and I'm so thrilled there are many of you here, is that we will need your help and support as we move through the budget process, as we always do. There are many faces that I see in the audience here that I have grown to love and gotten used to over the years, who attend our work sessions, who come and talk at our hearings, who talk to City Council about our school needs. And I just want to make you aware that we're going to need that kind of support from you again this year. So please feel free to reach out to any school board member. My name and number and email are on the website. We're happy to bring you up to date, listen to what you have to say. We would like you to be very much engaged in the process. So help us out. That'll be great. I think I'm just about out of time. So I just wanted to say one more thing, which is, as you may know, we have another vacancy on the school board. Joan Wodiska had been on our board for 10 years, has left to, she's been appointed by the governor to the Virginia Board of Education, which is awesome for her and awesome for all of us. But we will miss her. Her last meeting was last evening. If you will watch your inbox, we have put information out today to the community to let folks who might be interested in applying for that vacant position know what we're looking for and the time frames and the process. So if you have a hankering to spend your Tuesday nights with people like me, if you have time on your hands, if you have interest, take a look at that. If you have a colleague or a friend or a neighbor that you think would be a great advocate for our schools, you know, then mention it to them as well. Because we need to find the right person and get them in the seat in time for them to help and participate with our budget process. So I think with that, my time's probably up. And I'll close. Do you want me to introduce these guys? All right. Nader Baroukh, who's the mayor of our city, and Wyatt Shields, our city manager. I'll turn over the microphone to you.
That we've got several other council members here. I believe Vice Mayor Dave Snyder's here, Mr. Duncan is here, and Mr. Carter is here as well. So, along with some other elected officials who are here as well. So, if you've got any questions at the end of the presentation and after the meeting, feel free to talk to any of us.
Thank you, Mayor Baroukh. My name is Wyatt Shields. I'm your city manager. It's good to be with you this evening. You all have absorbed a lot tonight. It might be useful for everybody to stand up for just a second. Stretch.
Mr. Shields was a teacher in past life.
I'm channeling the teachers in the room. I have a number of slides, too many slides, in fact, and I'm going to go through them quickly out of respect for your time tonight. I've been asked to give an overview of the budget process, and I will do that, and also to provide a briefing for you about the agreement that ultimately the voters of the city will need to approve, but has recently been agreed to in principle between the City of Falls Church and Fairfax County for the sale of the city water system. And this does have importance for the city as a whole, but it also has importance specifically for the school community. I'll start with a budget overview and just have a few slides on that, and I'll start with revenues. This is where the money for the City of Falls Church comes from, and 59 or almost 60% of our revenues come from real estate, from property taxes. And of that real estate, about 80% of it comes from residential real estate. About 22% of it comes from the commercial sector. The rest of it comes from local taxes, and then this is fees, state and federal funds, but heavily dependent upon real estate and local taxes, and not so much dependent really upon the federal or state governments here in the City of Falls Church. And this is where the money goes. 44% of it goes for education, and if you include CIP and debt service, the largest chunk of debt service is for a school facility, with this school, Mary Ellen Henderson, being a big component of that, built in 2005. This share is generally school-oriented. And then going around the horn with administrative services, our court services, public safety is 14% of our budget, public works is 8%, our recreation, parks, culture, that's our library system as well, 6%. Our health and welfare programs, our planning and community development coming in at 4%. And so that's generally an allocation of where the funds go in the city. So looking ahead to 2014, our forecasts for the next year, so of course these are forecasts for economic activity 18 months from now. But on the real estate side, we believe that it's going to be modest growth, 1.9%. And that's better than it's been in years past, where we've had declines in real estate values, particularly and most pronouncedly on the commercial side, which has caused a distribution of the tax burden over to the residential sector as the commercial sector has declined in the recession. Personal property tax has been very healthy. Our Commissioner of Revenue here is in the room. He assesses that and collect, and the Treasurer collects it for the city. But people are buying new cars. We're forecasting 10% growth in personal property. All other taxes in the city, we're forecasting growth at 8%. And that is because we see already in our financial reports that we're ahead of schedule on our revenue collections for this year. So we have seen an uptick in our revenue collection, and we capture those in our forecast for 2014. But again, real estate being the largest share, overall our revenues grow a modest 3.2%. So that's what our budgets can grow if there were to be no changes in our tax rates. This graph is a little bit of the story of, and this is on the general government side. It does not include schools. But these are some cost of government per capita charts. And it compares the city of Falls Church, which is here in pink, with the city of Fairfax, with the city of Alexandria, and with Arlington County. And we can see we were clustered at about 1,800 back 10 years ago as a cost per citizen 10 years ago. That rose with inflation and cost of living increases through 2008. And the city did fall to the lower side of that of those four localities. And then as we've reduced our budgets, our cost of government per capita has dropped. Our general government is about 14% smaller today than it was in 2008, as we've made all the adjustments we've needed to make with the loss of revenue from our water utility and the recession. But again, with the shifting burden to the residential sector, a lot of people haven't seen that in their tax bill. And that's been the really difficult aspect of budgeting in the city of Falls Church for the past 4 years. Increased taxes and decreased spending and levels of service on the general government side. And in the schools, it's been a partnership in addressing these issues together. The city council adopts budget guidance to me, the city manager, so that we can check in with each other in November early in the process to set expectations for the budget recommendations that I will bring to the city council in March. And I'll highlight a couple of those, or perhaps the mayor would like to speak to them. Let me pass the microphone
to these. This is something relatively new that we've started doing as a formal matter. When I became mayor now several years ago, we instituted a process where we're actually formally adopting guidance that's going to the city manager. So similar to what we've done in the last few years, again, there's a concentration on operating the government as efficiently as we can and still providing outstanding safety and public service to our citizens. Two, revenue growth being tied to economic growth. Right now, we're forecasting between 3.2 to 3.4% roughly in growth. Again, very modest. And we'll talk about some of the caution signs that are out there. As you all are painfully aware with what's happening on the federal side, there's still the possibility of sequestration that's out there. That is going to have an impact in Falls Church. While we don't have contractors within the city, we do have federal employees and contractors that do live in the city. So we could see some pressure on housing as a result of sequestration or other federal budget cuts. So that's something that we're gonna have to face, and Wyatt will cover that briefly. And that's something that all the regional leaders have been talking about in various organizations. It's a topic of conversation at the various mayors and chairs meetings that I attend, which are a bit informal, but it's on every local leader's mind in Northern Virginia, and also further south in the Hampton Roads area as well. Third is a focus on capital needs and infrastructure. This is really a key area for the city. For a number of years, due to budget issues, the recession, the status of the water fund, and not being able to take any receipts from the water fund into the general fund, we did neglect our capital and our infrastructure. It was essentially deferred maintenance. We're now in a position of needing to address those issues, and we have the opportunity to do that. One of the biggest areas, and Wyatt's going to talk a little bit more detail about it, is the flooding problems and stormwater management. What I'll say before Wyatt talks about it in his slides, there's really two aspects of this. One is what we should be doing in the infrastructure as it is to simply keep up, but we're also seeing a lot of federal mandates and state mandates that are coming our way. And as I've said publicly, I do not want to be known as the city that gets the first fine. And the fines are significant. That's not what Falls Church is about. This is a problem that we are, and an issue that we have both a moral obligation and a community responsibility to manage and take care of. And it's not going to come cheap. It's going to be an area that, despite what you may read tomorrow, is going to be a lot of public discussion about it. No decisions have been made. There's going to be a lot of public engagement on this front before the council takes any action on that. And there'll be a series of town halls, which we're working on setting now. But I assure you that there will be a very robust public discussion about that process and how it unfolds. And we're certainly interested in getting your feedback on how to best do that. And the final point is something that is dear to my heart. And that's the multi-year forecasting for revenues and expenditures. It has really given us a sense of where we're headed with our revenue, expenditures, CIP, and how they all fit together holistically. One thing that we've asked the manager to try to do this year, we're going to be adopting a one-year budget as we're required to under the charter, but we're also looking at possibly seeing generally what the lines of operating costs are going to be for the next fiscal year, similar to how corporations and other bodies go about doing their budgeting, to give us a little bit more traction, let us know where we're headed in the next fiscal years up and coming. So those are some of the highlights. I'm happy to answer questions as we go through the presentation as well.
Thank you, Mayor. Looking ahead to some of the challenges for 2014, as the mayor mentioned, the status of the economic recovery, we're trying to forecast 18 months ahead for our fiscal year, and the uncertainty of what the federal government will do as it adjusts to major restructuring that needs to happen at the federal level casts doubt on our forecast. Capital needs, we've talked about facilities tonight, stormwater issues, those are two big ones. School enrollment growth is going to be a major issue for this year's budget. Employee compensation, our long-term obligations for VRS and city pensions, and we also are looking at inflation with our interjurisdictional contracts. We contract for fire service, jail services, and other services with the counties, and we're seeing, as they're under financial pressure, they're looking to pass on costs to us, and we're in very intense negotiations with them about those. Our five-year capital plan, we've talked about facilities a great deal tonight, and those are at the fore. We'll see Thomas Jefferson Elementary School be completed this year. The preschool facility at North Cherry Street, that will get underway in the coming fiscal year. And we have planning for Mount Daniel expansion. Public safety, city hall improvements are in the CIP. Firefighting apparatus, the city is responsible for buying the pump engines and the ladder trucks that you see out of Station 6 just down the road. Those will be in our capital plan. Stormwater, as we've mentioned, and then transportation. I don't know if you've noticed, but the bridge on Oak Street that you go across to get to TJ is under a weight limit right now because the steel underneath that roadbed is rusted out, and so we'll be replacing that bridge, and these things are expensive, so that'll be in our CIP. There are a lot of needs out there. Just a note on stormwater, and the mayor has mentioned it, so I won't go into great detail again. Key things, we need to catch up on infrastructure that was built 60 years ago, and we have major mandates that are coming down the pipe. It's all about preserving the Chesapeake Bay. It's good and it's important, but it will be expensive. So here's the schedule. I mentioned 3.2% revenue forecast for the coming year. We will revise that just in a few weeks once we have our second quarter financial report. The second quarter ends on January 1st. So we don't anticipate any major changes to that, possibly up to 3.4% or something along those lines from the 3.2 I mentioned. Some key dates, the school board will vote on the budget request to the city council in late February or early March, and I will present budget recommendations to the city council on March 11th. We'll have many public hearings. We also will have some Saturday public hearings that we do jointly with the schools, and then the council will adopt a budget after its third public hearing on April 22nd, and this is for a budget, of course, that goes into effect on July 1st.
Before we get into that, if I can just highlight thematically a couple points with the budget discussions and the guidance. With what Wyatt mentioned as far as we're looking and projecting about 3.2 to 3.4% increase in revenues, what that essentially means is we're not talking about new programs. A large chunk of that is going to essentially get eaten up by our interjurisdictional contracts and pension costs. So that's a key point, that even with that level of growth, we're not going to see lines of service increasing. So again, it's a very constrained budget. Our focus with the guidance that we've provided so far is focusing in on the capital needs of the city, such as stormwater, because we know that the price tags for those are going to be hefty. Also on some of the school capital needs that are out there. So we're keenly aware of the capital needs. So what we're trying to do in essence is put some constraints around the operating budgets so we can take care of some of the capital infrastructure needs that we know are out there, water, stormwater, school facilities, city hall facilities, and general government facilities that we think are critical at this juncture that we need to begin to address, or the price tags are just gonna get higher and higher as we move along.
So we're going to shift gears now to talk about the water agreement, and then we'll take questions, I think, for all questions for the night. And I'll go through this rather quickly. The voters ultimately will decide, and that the sale of the water system will be on the ballot at the election in November. So we've got time to process this information and make sure we've got lots of information out to the public about these terms. At the high level, here are the terms of the agreement. The Fairfax Water would purchase the city's water system for $40 million. The city, however, will retain our debt in the water system and our pension obligations, and those total out to be about $30 million, so net proceeds of about $10 million from the sale. Now, there's a provision also that allows the city to keep undesignated cash in the water system, but not to exceed $3 million. One benefit from the sale, Fairfax Water has lower water rates than the city of Falls Church, and Fairfax Water has agreed that after 2 years, the city rates will be lowered to the Fairfax Water rate, and then they will be uniform in perpetuity. They will go up over time, but there will never be a rate differential between the city and county customers. This is very important to us for the continuity of our water service. Fairfax Water will offer a guarantee of employment for every city employee that works in the water utility. There are 55 city employees that are assigned exclusively to the water utility, and they will go to work for Fairfax Water if that's their choice. This is the part that is particularly important for the schools. We have two boundary adjustments that are part of the agreement. A boundary adjustment is when the corporate boundaries of the city will be expanded to take in additional land. And it's in total of about 42.4 acres. And you recognize this site, but this is the George Mason High School. And so all of the school property will be brought into the city. And this is very important as we're doing our facility planning, that the city will be in control. And so the city, school board, planning commission, and city council, along with your input, will be the deciders and governors of how the site will be developed. Now, there is the potential, as we're going through that planning process, that an aspect of this could be for commercial development that would help finance any other redevelopment that needs to happen or for other city needs. But obviously, this location with the metro station here and access to I-66. It is a very important piece of property. But it will, as part of the terms of the agreement, 70% of it remain in school uses for at least 50 years. And that is the intent of all parties, that this remains the school site, but a portion of it could be used for commercial redevelopment. The other boundary adjustment that is part of it, the city owns property where our property yard is. The city has planned for years for economic development in the Gordon Road Triangle, and having this access to Shreve Road will be helpful for that effort. But for both of these, for any economic development purposes, these are way out in the future. We'll have lots of planning before we get to that point, and we'll do that very carefully. But those are the two boundary adjustments that are associated with the agreement. As I noted, we have a referendum that's scheduled in November. We have been in a dispute with the county for many years, and in a very acute conflict with the county for the past 6 years over water issues. And so it is welcome to get a resolution of that that I believe is very favorable to the city. There's certainly downsides to it, pros and cons. The water utility is one-third of our city operation. And when you talk about a lot of our back office functions like finance or HR or IT, we get a lot of economies of scale of having this large water system. And those back office functions will now be borne entirely by the local government of the city now. And there are costs associated with that. And so we'll need to absorb those. But there are also financial benefits to this agreement, and the City Council worked very hard to protect the city's interests, our customers' interests, and the city's long-term financial sustainability with the outlines of this agreement. So that's a quick summary, and now I will stop and allow for questions. But thank you for your attention, and look forward to your questions.
That would be what we think, and again, we're still going through the process of figuring out exactly how much is there as folks are working through the spreadsheets, et cetera. That would essentially be cash. And we've begun, and we'll have a pretty robust discussion about how to best use that. Speaking for myself again this evening, I hesitate to put that towards any type of operating expense. I think we need to figure out ways of ensuring that that goes towards long-term reinvestment in the city, and there's possible ways we can do that through the pension system in order to ensure that that money remains viable and is there for future generations as we go on.
Yes.
Yes, that's correct. It's a boundary adjustment, so there's it becomes in the city's jurisdiction, but it's city-owned land.
And I can't emphasize how important that is, and that was, without getting into the details of the confidential discussions that happened, was a huge sticking point. And I think we were all biting our nails, and I was still on the phone in the wee hours talking to Fairfax County representatives and board members. There was great concern about the control of the land. So I think they gave, and we gave, and ultimately I think we came up with a yes, winning situation for everybody. I think it's a win-win. I think my fellow council members really were critical and vital to the process. So was the county board, the water authority staff, Fairfax, and our city staff in making this deal happen.
Yes.
So I noticed from your pie chart that almost 50% of our expenditures are schools related to the city. How does that compare with other communities?
It varies very much between cities and counties. And typically in counties, the school budget is larger than 50%, and typically in cities, it's about 50%. And that's because cities have larger service requirements than counties do. For instance, taking care of streets and that type of thing. Yes? What was the revenue growth from 2012 to 2013, the current fiscal year? The actual revenue growth. I'll need to check that number. I don't have that off the top of my head. We actually have just finished our financial report for FY12, and that's posted on the city webpage. I confess I don't have it at the tip of my tongue. Right behind. Yeah.
For boundary adjustments, you're not the annual on the table part of the stuff. The issues with the capital projects need to be there, are similar to the issues.
Yeah.
I'll try to answer that the best I can. And we're still somewhat limited in discussing all the internals. And again, I think it's important for the community to understand a little bit about the process. Again, a lot of this was tied to the litigation and the mediation. So a lot of the internal discussions and offers and counteroffers, I believe, are still protected other than what the deal is. So that's why I'm about to give you an answer that may not be as clear as one would hope. But everything was on the table. So we had been looking at all options, and this is ultimately where we landed. But the land transactions were the most difficult, were also very important to the city, and we did have several discussions with the school board that I was president, other council members were, and city staff and city attorney in closed session with the school board. And we had a great partnership with the schools as this was progressing, oftentimes very, very quickly, given the litigation and the mediation. But all those issues were on the table.
Expanding on Mount Daniel site where it presently is in Fairfax County and in that neighborhood is going to be exceedingly challenging for us. The last time we expanded, it was exceedingly challenging for us, and things have changed in the interim that may make it even more difficult. So from our perspective, gosh, it would have been great, but that didn't happen. That's one reason why when Toni was up talking tonight, she was talking about maybe, you know, we find an alternate site or an alternate way, because we are sufficiently intimidated by the thought of doing it. It could take far longer than we need it to take in order to accommodate our kids and our schools. So that's a big problem for us.
And just on the water, as it relates to our relationship with Fairfax County, I'm hopeful that that dynamic is fundamentally different than it has been in years past. So while it's going to potentially be difficult, I would have said 6 months ago that it would have been extremely difficult to have those discussions with Fairfax. And that dynamic has simply changed. And I'm very hopeful that our interjurisdictional cooperations with Fairfax are gonna be heading in the right direction. And I'm seeing that in discussions that I'm having with their board members. And when I was overseas in Taiwan, I had the opportunity to spend some quality time with they're one of their board members. So those types of relationships become very important, and I think that we're on the path of forging much better relationships with Fairfax than we have in the past.
Yes. School board and the city, yeah. Yes.
To follow on to her question.
Yeah, you're up.
To follow on to her question about projected versus actual, were they similar? Were they quite different last year? Your revenue growth.
The our actuals on the revenue side from the years 2006 through 2010. All came in well below our projections. And that is a phenomenon in local government finance and state finance. And it was extremely painful. And so since that time, I'm very thankful for the fact that our revenue projections have come in below our actuals. And that's been true for the last 2 years. And so that's a positive trend. As I noted in our revenue projections, we are making up for some of that in our projections now. We have a 10% growth in personal property and an 8% growth in all other local taxes. That's not really what the economy is giving us in the next year, I don't believe. That's us catching up from under forecasting in the prior year. But we need to be very careful about those forecasts. It's a hard thing to do, to forecast 12 months and 18 months ahead. It'd be great to be able to do it perfectly, but that's our recent history. Yes.
My question has to do with back to the school facilities and the plans. Can you give us, I mean, in addition to the capacity projections, I'm assuming the planning process has also involved projections on costs, which obviously at this point would be very rough. But can you give a very quick overview of, at this point, what the unfunded, I mean, because the portions of this are currently covered in the operating budget, but the unfunded portion of the facilities planning is?
I'll try to answer that. When you look at what's in the CIP, I think that's a really good, you know, some of those things were in there last year and were approved to move forward, and then some are part of that planning process. But if you're looking at square footage, I'll just give you that idea, and you're building 275,000 square feet, they will tell us right now to plan for $350 a square foot. So it all comes back to how many students, how quickly do you build, and does construction keep going up? Because one thing that's reflected in our CIP that was approved last night is a slight increase in Cherry Street because construction costs have increased in the last year and a half. So that's the number that we use right now is $350 a square foot, which really sounds expensive, but we're in Northern Virginia. And if we were out, you know, on another area of Virginia, some of the new high schools that have been built, like Clark County, and they're building, and they actually built at a really good time, so they are considerably less than that. But that's the number that we're using right now because that's on the advice of the experts that are in the field. Does that help? Okay.
The CIP that was adopted last year had adequate funding. It may change this a little bit this year. Adequate funding to complete TJ, to build the Cherry Avenue facility for all ones, and to expand Mount Daniel according to the kind of plan that Toni put up there. And we think that, as I say, there might be a little adjustment, but we feel pretty confident we can do those projects within the city's finances currently. The elephant in the room is George Mason High School. It's old, it's inefficient, it's difficult to secure at best. The systems are, we can't even get parsers. I mean, you know, you all know, you've been there and you understand what that's all about. You know, that's gonna be an $80 to $100 million project, right? Goal. That's a lot of money for a town this small, a lot of money. And the school board and our college and city council have been doing a lot of working, talking, and thinking, and there's gonna be a lot more working, talking, and thinking about how we can do what we need to do at George Mason within the city's finances. And that's gonna take some creative, out-of-the-box thinking. We can't just sit and say, when can the city afford to bond $100 million for our high school? It's not going to happen. And we've kind of kicked the can down the road long enough. When I first was on the school board, I guess this is my seventh or eighth year on the school board, I can't remember, but we had money for George Mason, $30 million in the last year of the CIP. That would be 5 years out. And then the next year it was $30 million 5 years out, and then the next year was $50 million 5 years out, and we just keep kind of pushing it out and underestimating. So that's kind of the elephant in the room as far as facilities from the school's perspective. It's going to take a lot of community time and effort and conversation and collaboration to figure out how this community wants to address the problem of our high school.
And on the city side, I think you all can hear me okay without the mic, but on the city side, I think the big drivers for us, as I mentioned before, is going to be stormwater management and EPA requirements. Whether that goes in the CIP or whether that's done through an enterprise fund, one way or another, we're going to have to make some decisions or, you know, face the wrath of sanctions. So that's, you know, and they're hefty price tags. And I know staff is working hard to go through those and really scrub those numbers down as we're talking about levels of service and what's required. But again, I want to prepare the community that we're not unique of having to manage those. But again, those are all very expensive undertakings. But we're still trying to grapple with the numbers and really get our arms around scrubbing those. And then two is City Hall improvements, both public safety and other aspects. And then third is the library. I think those are some of the key projects that we're looking at, in addition to a lot of other infrastructure that we'll need to take care of, like bridges, pedestrian walkways, and roads, because we've been significantly cutting back on some of our operating expenses that are infrastructure related.
Dr. Jones, on your chart of school, individual school capacities and populations, how is the shift of the move from the eighth graders and the fifth graders going to affect those individual schools? Because I know it's going to have a big impact on George Mason.
Right. It does help George Mason, but the one thing you'll notice when you, and I encourage you to go home and really look at wherever your interest is, because there is so much information on there. George Mason, while it helps George Mason, when you actually look at the projection chart, they will be right back at 900 students within 3 years, which is where they are now. That's moving a grade out. So yes, it's really helping us on our biggest project that we need to problem solve on the longest. MEH, obviously, it's still three grades, but the elementary grades are growing. So as those cohorts and groups come up, that's why that building is growing. TJ, we're adding a grade. So even though we've added the new construction, we're okay with our eight sections. But again, it's built for eight sections. Next year, when we add second, third, fourth, and fifth grade teacher, that is needed. We're going to be at eight sections. So that's why this discussion at Mount Daniel is so critical. And we've talked a little bit about, you know, is there an alternative option where you could have a K-1-2 building? You know, but you have to be able to build that somewhere. You know, can you expand at Mount Daniel any more than what's on the plan now? What's on there now doesn't do a K-1-2, so you can't free up space at TJ with that current model. The other question I get a lot is, we have trailers at TJ. And people would like to see the trailers go away. We have to be very careful and cautious about, you know, really being thoughtful and watch our numbers and our projections and where those are coming in over the next year. They're not coming out right now because those may be a safety net while we are problem solving over the next 2 years, because that does give us several rooms right now. And as a matter of fact, we've been talking at Mount Daniel, again, with 9.5% growth, we may have to move pre-K to those trailers next year when those teachers are able to come inside at TJ. So in order to have space at Mount Daniel, if we have to add two more classes, there are no more rooms there. So we just share, we're really working hard behind the scenes, and the staff is, to problem solve.
Will it be a net gain or loss for Mary Ellen?
Mary Ellen right now is sitting, we were very lucky this year, because although we grew that, you know, 4.5% as a division, MEH had as many students move out as moved in, which that just hasn't happened traditionally. So they're sitting flat now. They will go up next year simply because of the size of the class sizes that remain here. Yeah. Yeah, all of the buildings continue to grow.
Let's get one in the back to the right, and then here and here.
Jim Custer. I've been told that other communities have been able to increase their capacity in their schools by going to year-round school, by staggering the school system. Is there any fact to that? And if there is there any appetite for it?
That's a really loaded question. Now, I will tell you, we have a creative calendar committee that's exploring all different options. But obviously in this community, I will tell you, I have been in a year-round system where I, you know, was in that system for 6 years. If you're on a traditional year-round calendar, does it truly help capacity? No, you're just, your schedule's different. If you're looking at what they do in California, because they have a bazillion children and, you know, they're running class sizes with 40 and 45 children in a class, what they do is they alternate week on, week off. I mean, it's more than a week, but you're sharing a classroom with two different teachers. So yes, there are ways to do it. Would it fit what our expectations are in Falls Church City? Absolutely not.
Now, you mentioned that 55 employees are in the water system. How many of those are based in City Hall, and has that been factored in the City Hall renovation?
16 of those are in City Hall, and they are factored into the renovation. The rest of them are at the property yard or right next door to the school central office in the flower room. here.
One question I have, the school population projections that always sort of make me scratch my head are associated with new condo apartment building coming online. As an example on the screen earlier, you had more than 200 units that are projected of only 20 kids coming out of those units, and those always seem totally off to me. I'm always thinking that if you have more than 200 units, that means only 10 units of two kids would live there, and that seems far too low. Associated with that question, I wonder what the original projection was for a building like Pearson Square, which now literally fills a school bus with kids every morning.
Yeah, and Pearson is very different, but I will say we're working so closely together, our departments at our administrative level, so we know that the data that we're presenting is accurate, because I can look at addresses of children, I can say how many of our children are coming from certain, and we've gone as far down, and I feel like we get better at it every time we meet and talk about it from the development side and from the city side. I can tell you, for instance, last year that when we look at the condos in the development, the one bedrooms that were at Pearson Square, Byron, Spectrum, and some of you probably know, I lived at Pearson the first year, I'm at the Spectrum the second year, so I have a good idea of all the little bodies around. But when we looked at that, not one of our children in the whole division, which surprised me, came from a one bedroom. Because I can actually look at the unit numbers and then know whether it's a one, two, or three. So that was a good, and whether that trend holds true, we don't know, but it's something that we'll be watching because it does help inform the city when they're talking about economic development and what, where we get a lot of children from. Pearson, I know that that was pre-me, but when it did change to a rental, and it does have a part of a State Department contract. So anytime it has State Department contract, we know that we're going to have, families from there.
Here. safety, City Hall improvements. We run a court in City Hall. And the court has 1950 style security. We have prisoners who are being brought in for gang-related violence through a common elevator into a public lobby. And they walk through their victims or their gang members to go into court. It's unacceptable. And we're soon, the judge is going to order us to fix that in some way. And so that's why that's a priority.
Can those services be farmed out to Arlington County?
Well, as a city, we are required to have court in the city. And we could go to the General Assembly and maybe ask for an exception on that, but that is the law right now, and that's part of what it is to be a city. So we explored that option. We haven't done full feasibility on it because that legal burden.
And I think, speaking as one council member, I think we do need to take a balanced approach. I don't think myself or other council members want to pit priorities against each other, but really look at holistically what can the city do, what can we afford to do, and how do we meet the various priorities that we have in a way that's productive. Again, that's why for several years I've been pushing for multi-year projections to try to balance that out, to figure out where we're headed in the long term, both from the school side and the general government side. And that's why we're talking about a 20-year facility plan above just simply the five-year CIP, and then folding into that, what can we afford and how do we pay for it? So I would encourage the community as a whole not to engage in discussions about this versus that, but if you can look at it collectively and holistically, I think we could end up in having even a greater city than we currently do. So that's my hope. And that's the approach that I plan on taking as we begin the budget discussions and the CIP and the facilities discussion. Because I think all those things are important. We're not just a city about public safety and libraries, et cetera, and we're not a city just about schools. We're a community. All those factors are important.
Yes, ma'am.
I was just wondering if you know what percentage of students come from State Department housing, and second, whether the city owns Oakwood. And the third question is whether the government gives us any assistance for the absorption of the foreign students.
We would like to afford Oakwood.
Especially when they come in short term for some sort of international crisis.
I have the percentage in my office. I don't have it in my head, but it's not as large as what people think. I will tell you that. When I came in my mind, the percentage was huge, but when I really ran the numbers last year, it wasn't as large. They're all at Oakwood, so you've got a huge bus stop there. But the percentage, when you look at over 2,000 students, is not as big as what some people think. And we don't own Oakwood, and we don't get extra money unless the city gets something that I'm not aware of. And we want it if you do. So, no.
Has there ever been any discussion? I mean, considering that we absorb people on
And probably one of the school board members may be able to answer that, better. Did you want to talk about that, Ms. Kearney?
Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to. Yes. Intermittently, we have conversations with the folks in the State Department, and they're unwilling to admit that they send so many children to our schools. You know, they suggest that children come to Montgomery, Falls Church, Fairfax, and it's really the family's choice. But somehow or other, when we have big, influxes with Egypt, the Arab Spring, I think a third to 40% of the kids who came back ended up in our school division. So they're just not willing to. We try. Every few years we go back again. We've tried getting our congressman to help us with that and haven't had any success with that either. If anybody has connections or ideas, bring them, because we would need to have them.
Can I add to that, Susan, too? One thing I try to really reinforce to the staff, and I just want to make sure the message is clear from me, that we so highly value our State Department families and what they bring to this community and to our schools, the international perspective. And sometimes I know, you almost feel like, oh, gosh, if we didn't have all those State Department families, that's what you hear sometimes in this community. And I don't think anybody means that. But gosh, they are so valuable to our school community and what they bring. And one thing I always caution staff, you know, if you imagine an Oakwood, a condominium of that size, and I toured that property when before I moved here just to see what it was like, it's huge. Now, if all of the State Department families pulled out of that condominium, what would they likely feel? They're not going to just let it sit empty. So it's still going to fill up. And it would change the composite of our school district. It's big enough to do that. And so I think you have to really be thoughtful when we think about how we wouldn't want them to take the contract from Oakwood and go to Arlington to a brand new condominium complex somewhere. So we try to be very thoughtful about that. And the staff know and love our State Department families. I actually have connections. So when something's going on overseas, I now have a number I call. They're very good to let us know as far as if we're going to have an influx, which happened, I know, before I came from Egypt. And so we're keeping that connection. So we do have that. So we know if we're going to have a huge influx. The children that come, it's so quickly after the break, we haven't really analyzed where they came from. But truly, I think it goes back to what Susan was saying, that it's so much of it is single-family homes. If you watch our board agenda, there's usually a family that's in renovation and going through the school board policy for a special approval to be able to renovate their home, and they have to move out for 2 months or 3 months. That's where we really see most of our families coming from. It's not like we have a huge influx of like condos or apartment addresses that we see this time of the year. When you think of 17 students that are moving in, because as a division, and that's what's so hard about school population, as a division, we didn't really have this huge spike. They just happened to be at that age level. So it's not like you have one class of second graders or one class of fourth graders. They're spread out, and you don't really know. It could have been early in the year, in September, we had huge high school numbers. We had a lot of kids that moved in for high school. So when we say a class of students, they're still spread out. What it does is it makes all those class sizes go up, you know, second, third, and fourth. As far as our daycare program that exists right now, and actually Katie Clinton is out there somewhere, I saw her. where we do run our before care and after care program.
Yeah, have they been included in any of these discussions on the new PJ card?
Oh, absolutely, yes. And Katie is actually on the committee where we meet on construction, and she's weighing in all the time with us. And we talked yesterday. We thought she needed a new little kitchenette. She didn't need it, but she may need new lockers. So the storage that's built for daycare, where their offices are, we have every department around the table as well as teachers to make sure that we're not missing an element. So daycare is very much in that discussion. And we had the discussion this week even about Cherry Street. And that's kind of scary because they're little bitty ones. But what would that look like at Cherry Street? So. Yes. Well, they really, I mean, and we talk about this a lot, they really have the capacity to be in classrooms or go to the media center, but being in that big open space is nice for them for aftercare. So that's really kind of a choice factor.
I'm confident we've hired the right people and we're all with you. If all of us got it wrong, and more kids come into the school system than any of us exist, if that were to happen, the $350 per square foot is a very good, helpful number for us to understand what it costs to build a school. $16,000 or $17,000 a year per student is a good figure for us to understand what it costs. What's the figure as we're building Thomas Jefferson? What's the figure per desk to add kids to our school system?
Well, what Mr. Kimball, and he could probably rattle off some really good numbers off the top of his head, because we run numbers all the time, and we do look at per student in our mind, because and when you look at a per student, it's not like every student has the same cost, but what happens is when you look at that division wide, and for instance, if we have a special needs student who enrolls in our division, and they may need a ratio of one teacher with three children. But then we may have another student who's in a classroom with 24, and their services are different. So you can't really say that every child necessarily has the same, they don't have the same needs, but you can look at a per pupil amount that at least gives you some guidance on that. Mr. Kimball, did you want to add anything to the numbers about... when you add a classroom, what I can tell you, and this is one thing that we work on, every time we have to add a classroom, we have to add furniture, we have to add supplies, we have to add, you know, when we added kindergarten and first grade this year, it took desks, it took tables, it takes manipulatives, it takes books. I mean, it's not just adding an $85,000 line item for a teacher. You have all of those other expenses that do come with that.
So what was the cost of the building, and how many students are we able to add?
At TJ, we have a task one and a task two. One is new building and one is renovation. One's $5 million, one's $4.9
million. So $5 million built a new building to add, how many do we
have? What I can tell you is that task one and task two, the money that we have invested in task one, we got unbelievable, I feel like, value for our money, because we did a PPEA, which this division had done before and was actually the first school division in Virginia that went through the PPEA process. And when you do that, you have all of these different people bidding, wanting your project, with the hopes that you're going to develop a great relationship, because when you're under a PPEA, for instance, when we want to go and build Cherry Street, we don't have to go back out and start that process again, which is also expensive, if we're happy with the relationship. So people want to build. After you've done the first project, sometimes you reach a point, you go back out and do that again.
Maybe what we should do is we will stay to answer additional questions, and that might be a way to go. But if I could just make one editorial comment. Just in our discussion tonight, particularly mine, in the PowerPoint presentation, I laid out not much revenue growth and a lot of needs out there. There are big challenges. No question about it. I do want to note that in 2010, when we really stared the recession in the face and we needed to completely restructure the way we could provide services, the city council resolved that we would emerge from the recession stronger than we went into it. And the good news is we have done that. We have restored fund balance. We're funding. We have capacity right now to fund capital that we didn't have in 2007. And that's through a lot of really tough decisions and great leadership from the city council. Richard LeCondre, our CFO, is in the back of the room. We want to recognize him. We went out in the midst of that. We got 0% interest bonds to build an expansion at TJ. And so a lot of very strong actions have been taken. So we've shown the capacity to rise to challenges. We'll do that in the future, and we'll do that with a lot of input and a lot of intelligence in this community to help guide those decisions. And so there's a lot of challenges, but my point is that there's reason to be optimistic that we'll be able to meet.
On behalf of all the PTAs, we want to say thank you to our speakers. I'm going to be the first to admit I've never been to a city council meeting or a school board meeting. And I'm ashamed of myself, but I'm going to start going now. To see all this interest and all these people, and I hope you all stay involved, because they've got a lot of hard work and a lot of big decisions to make over the next few years. So thanks everyone for coming. Stay involved, and thanks to all of our guests for giving so much of our time.